plans of getting into the film industry of Kerala. In 2010, I joined my first feature film project as a writer. I was to write a movie for Ashika. So I started scripting. The scripting was happening in Kochi. Packed my bags and moved to Kochi. I sat down with him in an apartment and started writing. And my this advertising agency that I am running right now is my family business. My father, Dr. J.V. Mohan, started the company in 1980. And so right now it's a 38-year-old company. So 2011, he was manning the show. So he is one person who wanted to become a filmmaker. And his father, my grandfather, never let him. So my father actually got a call letter from the Film and Television Mission of India in Pune. And my grandfather burnt it. So what he couldn't achieve, he always wanted his son to. His son, I have an elder brother, either of his sons. My brother opted a career in law, and then it was me. But he never asked me to become a filmmaker. You can't be made a filmmaker, you have to become a filmmaker. So maybe that gene pool was there in me. One day in 2005, I saw Apocalypse Now and I decided that I want to become a filmmaker. Incidentally, I'm screening that movie next week at the Bihar. So, yeah. I wanted to become a filmmaker. I went to film school. My father happily sent me. Spent quite a lot of money. I graduated in flying colors. I made 10 projects during my 2 years at Chennai in every person. I came back in right away. Got a feature film project. Got into that. Started writing. I was in Kochi in my zone, and my father was running the show. April 14th of that year was the previous day of Vishu. Usually Vishu falls on April 14th, but that year it was April 15th. So April 14th morning, I reached Trivandrum to spend the festival in Vishu with my family. I was at home. My father took at 10 a.m. he left for office. And by 10:30, I get a call from a friend of my father's. Picks up the phone. He calls the landline. So I pick up and then he's like, "Parthan, are you home?" I'm like, "Yeah, I'm home." This is the landline. Obviously, I'm home. Then he's like, "But I was kind of like passing a joke, but he's like, can you come to the PRS hospital right now?" I'm like, "Why? What happened?" "No, nothing. Mohan Chetan is not well." I'm like, "My father just drove to work half an hour back. What would happen to him?" He said, "Just come right away." And then he got the phone. So I took the car. I went to PRS. I parked at some hot spot. I walked into the casualty. I didn't know where to go. This person who called me obviously is not there. I enter the ER and I go to a nurse and tell my father's name. Just then the ICU, there's an inner ER there. The doors open and on a stretcher they bring my father. And the whole of his face was twisted to the side. And then there's a doctor who's rushing along with the stretcher. I hold the stretcher on one end. He's like, "For you." I said, "This is my father. Come with me." And then he drags me up. He rushed me. We both rush into an elevator along with the stretcher. We go to the fifth floor. And in between, I look at my father and he's conscious, but his eyes are rolling like two balls inside the socket. So I asked the doctor, "What happened?" Then he said, "We believe it's a stroke, but then we need to confirm it." I said, "Fine." And then they lift the doors open, they rush into the ER room. They call the neurologist and he comes out. He comes near my father, asks him, "What's your name?" And my father takes a gulp and he says, "Mohan." And then he turns to me, "Are you the son?" "Yes." "We need to do a CT." And then they go into the CT room. And then he's like, "You stay with your father." So they put a lead-lined jacket over me for the radiation. I hold my father down. And then the CT starts. And this huge machine like a circular disc makes a huge noise. I stand with him. Then suddenly he starts vomiting when he's lying down. So the vomits get into his face and he snorts up. So then I turn to him on one side and to let the vomit go. So the doctor comes rushing out. And then he's just clean him up. We need to finish the CT. I put him back along with the nurse help. We finish the CT. And then the doctor calls me in from the control room. I walk in. And then he points me out, below the brain, he points me out a spot where there is a block of blood. Which has it has plucked off from his heart and it's now traveling up his brain. But it's on his right carotid artery and it's just, right now it's wedged there. So At any point, it could unwedge itself and go to his brain, which will cause a hemorrhage and he'll die right away. Or we need to hold it there, open it up, and then take it out. So right by this time, I'm completely numb. I don't know. I'm not even like talking back. Then he's like, "We'll do one thing. Let's not keep him here." So then, again, I'm like, "Okay, then we need to take him to Sri." That's the only place in Kerala where this could be done right. I'm like, okay. And then he tells me something. The doctor, his name is Dr. Madhusudan, he tells me, "But don't tell this hospital people because they won't let you. So do one thing. You call out and you call an ambulance from somewhere outside. Don't use this hospital ambulance. You bring a hospital ambulance from outside. I'll give you an informal discharge." So by this time, one of my uncles have like got an office and he came. He went out, called out an ambulance. A small pony ambulance comes. He writes a paper discharge, gives it to me. Said, "If the security asks, just give it to him." And then we go out on the stretcher, we take him off. The security comes like, "Sir, sir, discharge paper." I just give it to him, puts him on the car, puts the ambulance siren. He gets inside and within 5-10 minutes, the ambulance driver takes us to Sri Yadra. Now, Sri Yadra is a place where, you know, it's a strictly a referral hospital. They don't admit people when you walk in. You need to be referred from some place. So we reach there, and I reach there, and I can see that by the time I got there, this uncle who got onto the car, he calls up a nurse that he knows there and tells him about the situation. So that nurse arranged a stretcher there. So by the time we are there, we just put him right onto the stretcher and took him. So as I walked him, this nurse was with me. And then this person from the counter calls me and says, "Hey, you need to fill out the papers." And then one attendant comes to me with the paper. Before I could respond, the nurse grabs it, crumples it in front of me, throws it out and says, "You go with your father, I'll take care of this paper." I go with my father, this very calm, peaceful lady called Dr. Shailaja, she's a neurologist, she comes up. She takes me again, one more CT room. In half an hour, I'm entering my second CT room. Goes into the CT room. They do another scan, and then this time again calls me to the monitor and said, "This is this clot again." I said, I wanted to say, yeah, I just saw it. But then it's like, it's still there. We could localize it and take it out. But then I have no guarantees that it will unwedge itself or it will stay there. And there's a 70% chance that it will unlock and go into his brain and then we can't do it. I said, "Fine, let's go for it. If you're ready, then I'm ready to sign the paper." So by this time, I didn't want to tell my mother, but my mother comes to know if she has reached the hospital, but she's not let into the CT room. So I said, "Fine, I'll sign the papers," and then I sign the papers, and then they take him inside. And then there's the next 3 hours. This next 3 hours is the longest 3 hours of my life. I wait outside the operation theater. And then they take him inside, and then the anesthesiologist says that my father's diabetic for 25 years, he's got hypertension, there is no way the anesthesiologist will sign the papers, sign the clearance. And the Dr. Shailaja says, "It's okay, I am taking personal risk, just go ahead and do it." And then they start the procedure, it's 3 hours. In this 3 hours, I'm standing outside, my mother is there, she's completely shattered. My brother in Dubai, he calls me up. I don't tell him the deal. I said, "Father, that's not well." And then they just cut the phone. But in this 3 hours, I get to know what happened. Now that is the story in this whole incident. This is a personal incident, could happen to anyone. Did not happen to anyone, but yeah, I'll tell you what I contradict with Bharat. So at 10 o'clock my father leaves. At 10:15 he reaches the signal in front of Women's College, the Annie Mestrian Square. He's parked in front. He's listening to some music. He's driving his Corolla car. The signal changes from red to green. His left hand that is kept on top of the gear, it doesn't fall to first. He can't move his left arm. Then he can slowly feel that his whole left side one of his legs is on the edge. Luckily not on the clutch, but the whole left side is like completely paralyzed. So the signal changes, all the workers behind him start bearing the horns, but this person, my father, can't take his work. So one thing that he did was, from his side, he had rolled the window down. So the traffic person comes and says, "Sir, move the vehicle." And then he can see that my father is trying to say something, but nothing's clear is coming out from his mouth. This traffic person opens the door, takes him out, makes him sit on the animus screen square and tries to talk, "Sir, where and that? What's your name, sir? Where are you from?" And then he can't talk anything, and he's got his hand firmly on his pocket and inside there is a wallet. So he's not letting go of his own hand. So this person is trying to undo the hand, but nothing is happening. So he calls up 108, the ambulance service. They are here in 5 minutes. So this 5 minutes is what they need to keep hold of my father. So the standard protocol of 108 is that the moment the vehicle comes, it has to be taken to medical college casualty only. That's the rule. Can't go to any other private hospital. And when an unknown stranger is taken there, they just let him there be, and they won't attend until they get the whereabouts of someone close in this there. Which means my father will be probably lying there without being recognized for the whole of that. And he's having a stroke. And stroke has a 2-hour window. If you don't retrieve in 2 hours, that person will have permanent nerve damage, permanent paralysis. So in 5 minutes, the 108 is coming. Few people have stopped their cars and bikes, and they're all just standing near it. No one knows who this person is. And then five cars behind, my father's sister has taken a wrong turn and accidentally ended up in that city. So she's again not looking at this person. She's swerving away from all this hullabaloo. One fleeting look, she looks at who has created this accident in the morning. She looks at one person sitting in a chair. And she said, "That's my brother." She parks the car haphazardly. She comes to the traffic person and says, "This is my brother." You know, they're like, "Okay, we don't know who this was. We called up the 108. It will be here in 2 minutes. Do you want to take him there or do you want to take him to the hospital?" And my aunt, she's panicked like hell. She can't function. One person, his name is Arun Vinod, total random stranger. He's working for GM Motors as a driver. He parks his bike there. He comes there. "Madam, take him and put him inside your car. I will drive him there." He takes the car. In 5 minutes, he takes him to PRS. And then he takes him inside. And then another person, this person who called me, was an acquaintance of my father. And he again was three cars behind my aunt. She sees my father and then calls me up random, saying that Mohan Jaran is unwell. And that's how I come to him. And the doctor there, the head of neurology, instead of admitting him there, tells me, "I'll give you an unofficial discharge. You take him to the hospital where your father will be safe." We take him there, and this nurse, who total stranger, she grabs the paperwork from my hand, saying that, "Don't waste time. Go inside with your father." The anesthesiologist, who says, "I'm not willing to give you a clearance," Dr. Shailaja, a random stranger I didn't know, says that, "That's it. I am taking the responsibility." And so she is saying that 70% chance of person dying. "It's okay. Go inside. I'm giving you the clearance." I'm releasing this whole chain of events in this 3 hours that I'm waiting outside. And after 3 hours, Dr. Shailaja comes out. I'm looking at myself and my mother looking at her and seeing that we had a complete recanalization. The whole clot is removed. We will have full blood flow in the next 30 minutes. But then we can't guarantee any movement until 6-7 in the evening. Again we wait. At 7, Dr. Shailaja comes again. He's in the ICU. Comes near him. Makes him, they tap a hammer on both knees. So taps on the right, his good hand, good leg. He moves it. We all wait. Taps on the left. He doesn't move. We all wait again. She looks at me. Taps again. He flinches a thumb. Then she's like, "Okay, now it's all up to you. It's an uphill. But how did he land?" Then she asked me, "How did he land up here?" And I'm like, "Long story, I don't want to tell you." And I haven't told her till date. My father is now back. I mean, he has made an 85% recovery. He can move. He can walk on his own. He can't function in his official capacity, of course. He had a slur, but he has managed to overcome the slur. But I can tell you without any doubt that I started believing from April 14, 2011, and I believe in the random kindness of strangers. The world, just like Anja said, the world conspires for things to happen. And all these people, these 8 or 9 people I told you, right from the traffic policeman who dragged my father out, right till Dr. Shailaja who did that surgery at her own risk, all these 10 people were random strangers to me till that day. So yeah, believe it happens.